night. And remind the board that somewhere around between 7:00 and 7:30, we're going to call Chad Berg to talk about abatement processing. All right, first order of business are the approval of the minutes of April 2nd. And we can just do it by consensus if everybody's good. I did change, I added a sentence, and I did that this afternoon.
I did not say that, but.
Okay, it was, I don't know exactly what it was, let me look it up.
Is that important?
I thought, yes, it was, all right, it was the fire.
No.
It was Chief Rutherford.
Yeah.
And I added that he, when he was talking about the communications, he told us that, you know, the analog would be good for 10 years, but we would, really should be planning at that point to switch over to digital.
Yeah.
And we said, let's make sure it's on the CIP.
Yes.
That's the sentence I added.
Okay, I'll agree to that.
There was nothing else, there was nothing on it.
Okay, yep, I'll agree to that.
Yep.
Thank you.
All right.
Okay.
All right, so the minutes are good, community input. All right, so department head, Mr. Gilmet. Are we going to go directly into not?
One item.
Let's do your one item, then we'll.
It's a PO for Bobcat of New Hampshire for the articulated brush mower. Came in less than we expected.
Even better.
For the mower plus the counterweight kit installed, $9,700.
$12,000, so.
All right, I'm going to purchase order number 1118 to Bobcat of New Hampshire for $9,700 to come out of warrant article number 6.
Do you have the book? Michael's going to get the book.
I don't remember where I'm looking from. Warrant article number 7. 6 is yours too, Chris.
All right, so Michael moved it, do we have a second?
Second.
All right, nice work. Is there any other?
No, no, it's going to go right in the front of the, the side of the Bobcat, or front of it, whatever it fits on.
Yeah.
Any comments, questions? All right.
Now, if we, for some reason, George, I'm sorry, I just wanted to talk.
That's okay.
If for some reason, well, if not for some reason, eventually we will need to buy a new Bobcat, and they don't last forever. This attachment, we presume will fit on the next generations of Bobcat? Do we have that conversation at all?
It'll fit on any machine that takes a Bobcat attachment, and it all universal pretty much now, so.
Okay.
Give us a couple more options.
Awesome.
All right. We good? All right, all those in favor say aye.
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 Thank you.
Excellent.
Only one thing, they may change the wiring on this, and that happens.
Okay, and that's something we can handle?
They probably have to wire it this way.
Oh, okay. All right.
Do you want to see it? No. Do you want it back?
No, Caroline.
Caroline wants it.
I guess the only, is it true that the only ones we give back are to Chief Ducharme?
Yes.
Is that really the process?
Yes.
All of the RS we put in the folder?
Yes.
Thank you. Very good. All right, so no other business? All right, then I will entertain a motion to go into non-public for purposes of discussing a contract.
I will move that we go into non-public session for, deal with contractual issues.
Any second?
Second.
Okay, and I'll also ask verification by a roll call, Michael?
Yes.
Denise?
Yes.
Suzanne, yes. Oh, right, okay, got it. Yes, we're back.
I would like a motion to move the bid from Hex Industries for the road work done at, with Run and Heritage Drive.
And I will second that and add that the sum total of the proposal is? hang on just a minute, I know it's somewhere, is $298,082. And I've seconded it, and we put it on the floor, and I would like to make some other comments. 4 years ago, we started an RFP, a request for proposal process, a very public bidding for a road surface project, and Pike was the winner of that bid. And the next year, we did another request for proposal, and had a, so it was another public bid process, and Pike also won that bid. And last year and this year, the board, which it has every right to do, there's no state statute or any RSA that says we have to do public bidding. Public bidding is generally a good thing, and I'm generally very supportive of it, but we've had a very good relationship with Pike, and so the board, and its wisdom, has decided to continue that for at least one more year. So given that, I have a motion to sign a contract from Pike Industries for the work on Woods Run, the Woodlands, and Heritage Drive.
I'm going to abstain from the vote, Madam Chair, only because I don't want any, even the appearance that
Your phone's offline, so I can't help you with that at the moment.
Okay, I thought that was hearing voices. Okay, that's a good thing that I'm not. Because of where the scope of work, we're not going to be able to do all of the work on Heritage and Moses Carr this year. We're breaking it up into pieces. I don't want anyone to think that
you influence.
I'm influencing because I, in fact, I think that from what I understand, what we're even said, part of the work maybe is beginning at the beginning part of it, which is where my mother lives, and I don't want anyone to think that I'm
understood
influencing any decision on which end of the road to start on. So
fair
it's
nice.
All going to get done. But.
So are you ready for me to put it to the vote?
I am.
All right, all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? No. All right, one abstention. We will sign the contract. And I will sign the contract. I guess it's just me. So I'll initial this, the other pages. And a thank you to George and Caroline for helping to make this happen with both the Pike and with getting the contract out. So thank you both very much. Next year, though, I hope we're not like at the last minute. So we'll get a running start next year. All right. And Caroline or George will be contacting Chris.
If you can just make sure that the attachments are with the contract, I'll scan it and email it to George and Chris in the morning.
Okay. So it says Town of Rollinsford, signature. I did that. Print name, I did that. And then it says Select Board Town of Rollinsford. Is that just an extra line we don't need?
Yeah, you don't need that. If you wanted to date it somewhere, that's probably a good thing.
Yes, I was going to do that.
Then they're going to sign the other side.
We'll get a copy of that. Yep. All right, so that's that. These are the attachments. And just so the public knows, we will in fact be doing the entirety of Woods Run. Part of it is being reclaimed, not all of it. Part of it will be reclaimed, but the whole of it will be overlaid, and there will be some gravel work that some of which George will, our road agent and highway department will be doing. On Roberts Farm, we are going to be doing a box cut in that part that's roller coastery at the beginning to cut that out, you know, replace, hopefully we don't have to go down to like Australia, but, you know, replace the material that's there with better material, stabilization fabric, and it will, and we're also going to reclaim part of it. So there is some reclamation work that will be going on Heritage as well. The part that's being reclaimed as well as this box cut part will have a binder coat put on, which is similar to what we did on Bear Road. When we did Part A, we did a binder coat, then finished it all next year. So next year, as we said at town meeting and budget hearings, et cetera, we will complete Heritage. But all that we'll need at that point is the overlay. Correct, George?
Shim and overlay.
Shim and overlay for the
entire. And then the shoulders will be done next year.
Yeah. All right. Okay, that's this year's project for a total of just under $300,000. We're gonna hold off on deciding how best to deal with the remainder of the $325,000 in road maintenance until we see what the extent of the contract is, because there could be some cost overruns if they do have to go down to Australia, that could be expensive. So we're hoping that doesn't happen. All right. Did I do that right, George? Did I say that correctly? All right, so I think we're good there. Is there anything else, George, that you needed?
I'm good.
Well, thank you again, and thank you, Caroline. We hope to see you next Monday. Have a good day.
Oh, yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you. All right, let's get back. This is, can I give this to you? I don't wanna hang on to this, so could you please come and retrieve this? And make sure that I signed and initialed everything. Thank you. And you don't need this, so I can just, you can just. It was last week's version of what you were giving us.
Yep.
All right, I see Chief Rutherford, so let's put aside the building inspector if you wanna come up and.
Just one item.
And please remind me I have to go back to the. I finally saw the new fire engine, although to be honest with you, I was patting the old one because it looked so shiny when I first walked in.
Yes.
Very bright hood, you know, the.
Yeah,
Suzanne's the next one, it's the next one. Then when I saw the sides, I says, oh, yes, of course.
Look at our train. It was nice seeing you all at that event. It was very busy.
There were a lot of children there.
A lot more than I normally would see.
There were a lot of children, but that's a good thing.
It was a very good thing, yeah.
It's a lot of energy in that room.
Yes.
Yes. Most of them were mine, and they were not behaving.
And they went home with all of us, so you're all welcome for that.
I have one purchase order, 1339, and it's to the Seacoast Technical Assistance Response Team, otherwise known as START. And it's for our annual dues for our hazmat response team. $604.
Okay. PM1339, Seacoast Technical Assistant Response Team. Annual dues for the hazmat response team for $604 coming out of this hazmat account.
Second.
Any discussions? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
The way we figure the 604 is a per capita, but it's also based on a danger rating scale, which we have a rather substantially higher.
Because of all the woods, or what?
Because of the railroad train.
Oh, hazardous material. Of course.
Yep. Yeah, it's a really common scale because of what goes over that railroad. I get to look at it every day about 20 times a day, but it's the Amtrak thing. And the Amtrak thing is not hazardous in that regard, more so towards human life side of it as a rescue scenario. They would be involved in that also, but it's more for the freight that comes in.
Oh, I know, the stuff. All I can think of when people, or when I think of that, I don't often think about it because I prefer to just deny, is that village in Quebec.
Mm-hmm.
Well,
that was the oil train that got,
yeah.
Wasn't braked properly and rolled down the hill. There was a train wreck here back in the
80s.
Really? Yep.
Late 80s, really? 17 yep. cars fell off over behind where the rail splits between the gravel train that heads north right there. They had an accident and 17 cars fell off. And actually two cars after that managed to stay on the rail was a fully loaded chlorine car. And if that had fallen off the tracks, I may not have been in a little town. It was that close.
Yeah.
That was a big event
about.
For this town.
Yeah.
And anytime there's something like that. So, but that's how they come up with that.
Well, that's interesting to know because it's a, you know, we wouldn't know. We just unless you told us. So that's illustrative. Thank you.
That's my job. That anyone goes up and down Route 4, pretty much.
So it's not so much the stock of housing that we have. It's really.
No, and then like the oil plant came into service a few years ago, so that's part of it. The greenhouse is a pretty big target, and they have that oil distribution area there too. So as more things like that come online, like a storage facility or processing facility like that, it just creeps up a little bit.
Okay.
Just some of the hazards that people don't realize are there.
For sure.
Yep, so, that's all I got.
All right, I think we're good.
All right.
Thank you so much. All right, let's go back to housing insurance. So, yes, are there letters? Oh, yeah, you. She says, I'm so sorry.
It's okay, there are letters in your file, but when you're ready, I'd like to go into non-public.
Yes, so is the topic.
There are, the ones on the agenda are in the file.
So we don't have to go back to it then, and now we will just go into non-public.
I'll move that we go into non-public session to hear welfare petition.
Second.
And I'll do the roll call, Michael.
Yes.
Yes.
Suzanne, yes. So sorry, Carol.
It turned off and we don't.
It knows that I didn't have a signal, that's interesting.
You ready? So for welfare case 2018-002, select board is recommending up to $800 in rental assistance.
Okay, take that as a motion.
Second.
Any questions or comments? All those in favor say aye.
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 Thank you.
Thank you, Carol. All right, we are not going back to the building inspector code enforcement because there are letters in the folder, but look at when they come.
Okay.
When we get there, so we'll just move on.
Okay.
All right, first meeting chores. So we have some more committee appointments to think about. We have, actually, I should have put conservation commission too. So I'm adding that. All right, well, let's do ZBA. So this was the list that we appointed. I don't know if you can see it, but it's up there. I don't know which way I should go. So since we started sending out the letters to notify people that they were either continuing on because they had appointments that were not over, we've had two resignations from the ZBA. One from Ron Shabbat, who is resigning, and Howard Hammond, who is resigning. So, Ron resigned April 1st by email, Howard Hammond resigned April 2nd by email, and I forwarded both of those to the board. On the 5th of April, I emailed both alternates, Paul Cazalt and Deanna Rollo, to see if they would accept an appointment to be a full member. On that same date, I got responses from both of them. Paul declined because of other obligations. And Deanna Rollo said that she would accept full membership, so there's that. And then on, it says April, yes, on April 5th, we also heard from Ken Ward emailing his willingness to serve. I hope I forwarded that along to you as well.
Mm-hmm.
And today, Charlie Putnam wrote to us, emailing his willingness and also outlining his past experience as chair of the planning board, his legal background, and the like. So we have... So we have two full memberships. I think it would be, I would recommend that we look at Deanna Rollo, who was an alternate, who is agreeing to serve as a full member. And I would also like to see Charlie Putnam, because of his experience, to be full members.
Does the alternates participate in the meetings?
They show up. Well, I don't know how Joe has run them. I think he knows who's going to be there.
Mm-hmm.
And it looks like he doesn't have a full ZBA. He will call on an alternate. So I don't know. It's not quite like the planning board where the alternates are often there.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if
the alternates are typically at the ZBA and they
oh, thank you.
They sit and listen to the case, and if
someone
if they need a quorum, then mm-hmm. the former chair would appoint them as full member that evening. Mm-hmm. But they usually, if they're available, they attend and listen to the case.
So they're notified at the meetings and all of that, so they can go if they choose.
They have been, I don't know.
Yep. Yeah. Okay.
And the secretary, recording secretary, manages
yes.
that on behalf of the chair, if the chair so chooses.
Okay.
I think that Joe had a he was pretty hands-on too, so I'm not really sure, but anyway, yes, so the alternates do, are there.
So did Paul also say he did not want to be an alternate, or
no, no, he
wants to be an alternate?
He will remain as an alternate, he feels he can't make a commitment for full membership, so.
So we need one full and one alternate?
We need two fulls and one alternate.
Well, two fulls, but we'd already offered it to Deanna.
We didn't offer it, I just asked.
Oh.
I asked, would you be willing to accept it? No, this is, we didn't, there's no, I'm sitting here saying, well, you know, she was already an alternate, she did say she would accept it, so I'm just offering that up.
But we can put two people on?
We can put two people on.
Okay, so we could put Charlie and Ken on.
And keep Deanna as an alternate?
Well, no, I meant just in total.
Yes, all three people who said that they had, the two new ones.
I mean, I think we should give Deanna, only because she's been an alternate, and she should be able to have the right to move forward, and she acknowledged that she would accept it. And I would like to see Charlie, just because of his background, I think would be extremely useful to be the full-timer, and possibly Ken to be the alternate.
That sounds like a good, sounds like a good slate. Would you like to formulate that as a motion? And we...
Separately, I will vote on some of them.
Oh, yes, all right, yeah, very good point, Mike, thank you for that. So let's do Charlie, and I would, we have got two positions that are open, one that ends in 2020, one that ends in 2021, so you might want to consider maybe the 2021.
To be...
For Charlie.
Charlie, yes, yeah. Okay, so I'll make a motion that we put Deanna Rolo in to replace Ron Shabbat with the expiration of 2020.
All right, I will second that, and... are we ready to call a question? All those in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right.
And I'll make a motion to...
I'm abstaining.
Abstain.
Yeah.
I'll make a motion to put...
Charles?
Charlie Putnam in replace of Howard Hammond with an expiration of 2021.
Second.
Oh, Kathleen, I have a question.
Yes.
Okay, because it's an appointment versus an election, you can go beyond the 1 year? Okay.
Yes, I believe so.
Okay.
I believe so. Because, you know, next year's board would not necessarily, I mean, we can always, a board can always change the appointment.
Okay,
but
just wanted to make sure.
Yeah.
Because with an election, you only do it to the next vote.
Exactly.
So, I made one.
Yes. Charlie Putnam for the 2021 position. Did you second it?
Yes.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. So now we have Deanna Rolo's alternate position.
I will make a motion to appoint Ken Ward as the alternate, replacing Deanna Rolo.
Second.
Is it Kenneth?
Yes.
Okay.
J.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any comments? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you. So I will send the three folks a new appointment letter. Mm-hmm. And at some point,
I think I had agreed to
to meet with them?
To host the first meeting.
Excellent. That's
but I would respectfully
because
decline
of
the invitation now.
All right. All right. I think that's fine. I'm happy to do it. I will not be able to do it until I come back from my road trip. But I'm doing
when are they having it?
Well, they don't meet unless it's on call.
Oh, okay.
So we would presumably things don't happen in a hurry, do they? Right?
Well, when are you Monday, I mean, something could come up.
It's a week from tomorrow.
So something, I'm trying to think of how.
When are you meeting?
When they need to give, well, I could do, I'll do the planning board one. That's not an issue. The issue is if a case comes up, they have notice requirements. So what's going on today is.
Cases are prompted by our denying a permit, correct? What else?
Not always. Not always.
What else?
So there could be some complications with lot line adjustments where they know they need to go to the ZBA and not to the, because that's happened before.
Mike, what's your conflict?
My mother's
which doesn't necessarily mean she's going to run for chair.
Well, no, I just don't want to be involved with the election.
I sort of understand. It could be awkward. I get that.
So
I'm looking at my
so there could be cases that come up that just automatically go there.
Right.
Like the Mr. Apsey, If you really want departments, should have started there to make sure he was gonna get his exemption first, but,
So, so I could do, you know, I would plan on doing it like that, the week that starts April 30th, so the first week of May, so when I get back, so I could.
But isn't it enough that they have to do something in a hurry and someone can call me and then we'll go up there?
Yeah, 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 exactly.
I mean, that would be fine, whatever, you know, if something happens.
It's just to assemble them.
Right.
Give them the opportunity to elect a chair, I don't believe they need any other officers. I would also use the opportunity, because I, and I sent this in the appointment letter, you know, there's a ZBA handbook online that they should feel free to become familiar with if they've not taken that opportunity.
Okay.
So if you're gonna take that one on, I'm happy to do the, what's that, Conservation Commission that we were gonna do?
That's this week, I've already started it, so.
Oh, fine, okay, fine.
But you do the planning board?
Yeah.
I'm happy.
That'll be May, probably on the calendar. May, I have it on my calendar, but I don't remember the day, six maybe.
And I'm doing a budget committee.
Yes.
May 9th.
Yeah, so the budget committee has been postponed from Wednesday of this week to 2 weeks.
It's the 18th, isn't it?
Oh, no, just 1 week then, not 2 weeks.
It was one, it was supposed to be last week, that's why.
Oh, I'm sorry.
So it was 2 weeks out from there, I think it's the 18th, yeah.
Yeah, and I am not, I am going to be still away, yeah, so thank you, I appreciate it.
You're gone too, yeah, I will do it, yeah.
So what happens, didn't get noticed properly or something?
Yeah.
Yeah, and so, the Conservation Commission, just some additional follow-up in case, because we do have another resignation. And, you know, when I did some research to find out how often they had met last year, just for background information, I realized that they hadn't been posting meetings. So there'd been nothing posted on the website, and Caroline said, you know, cleans up our bulletin board, there had been nothing posted there. So we need to get them plugged in to, you know, be doing this. I couldn't find minutes, town clerk doesn't have minutes. They're not on the website, although that's not a surprise. But we'll get a sort of a, you know, kind of like a reboot and get them to be using the website. So the resignation that came in today was from Larry Larkin, and he is so busy with peas. And he had no idea of anything else happening with the Conservation Commission, but he's just really busy. So he resigned. He has an appointment that goes to next March. And so I sent an email to the alternates, who are Lorraine Hansen and Jackie Schroeder, asking if either one of them would accept an appointment. But knowing that in mid-March, somewhere around there, Lorraine had declined being appointed to full membership. So I didn't hear back from her. I did hear back from Jackie Schroeder that she would accept an appointment as a full member. So we could consider appointing her, and we could, you know, at a leisurely pace, look for another alternate for the Conservation Commission.
And the issue with the previous chair is resolved? Because what I saw in the email was still addressing in 1719.
I don't...
Well, I mean, just because of notification that they were going to be on it. And that was 1719.
All? Right, that was 17, and, it, right. And my response said, we'll wait for you before we finalize it all, because so we have the full commission. And that, it never happened. Never happened. And so I reiterated all of that in January. I said, you know, and it's in the town report. It says that they, two people were in a term that expired in, I think these two, in 2017. So, I mean, so we were as open as we could possibly be, and so, in any event.
So are any of the three folks that were previous members that are no longer members, are they interested in coming back as alternates?
They, possibly.
Maybe we should start there.
Al?
And Al or Dan or who's the other person? Mark.
Mark.
Did you get any reply on your notification to them?
Not directly, no. I mean, Al, we got it last week.
Well, yeah,
yes.
No, I meant Dan and...
Dan, nothing. And I think, I don't believe Dan has been attending meetings. I mean, Mark is attending meetings. Yes, I mean, shall we do that?
I would think that'd be a good place to start.
Let's start there. Sounds good.
And if neither of those gentlemen are interested, then put out a call again to the whole town.
Okay.
So are you proposing not to replace the full-time position?
No, if you want to do the same process that you did with the ZBA of asking the alternate first.
Well, we just, I did that.
She did that, and she said she would.
We don't have to appoint. If, you know, I feel that if somebody was a full member and is showing interest, I would prefer to make them a full member.
I'm sorry, I'm not a full member, what's that?
Well, all right. So if we were to appoint Jackie Schroeder today to take Larry Larkins, then we have our two alternates?
You have one alternate.
Yes, one alternate, sorry, one alternate.
Yeah.
So are you suggesting that we ask these three people if they would want to be an alternate?
Either of them want to come back as an alternate, because you've got an opening. I mean, yeah, I'm okay too if you want to hold off and ask them if one of them not do, what? Jackie Schroeder, is that who it is?
Jackie Schroeder.
If you want to hold off and ask one of the other people if they want to come back as a member and not appoint her, I don't know what to do anyway, so it doesn't matter to me.
Was Dan and Mark members or alternates?
They were all three were members.
I mean, if Dan's not showing up, I mean, well, he can speak for himself, I don't want.
Yes, I'm happy to do that. I can do that.
I'm just thinking, I mean, if there's this much, animosity, I guess probably the best way to put it, of not being reappointed, regardless of not responding or whatever, get that. But if the people are upset that, you know, that they sincerely want to serve, then they shouldn't be offered a position back, I think, so.
But we also have to make sure that everything is transparent.
Yeah.
And so, I mean, because of some of the people who are in the guiding, the chairing mold, or whatever you want to say, weren't very transparent in their meetings and posting them and minute taking everything, that
well,
has
I
to
think
happen.
That, yes, and I think that's why it's a good idea to have a select board member there at the first meeting to just remind the group that, and it was in the appointment letter, as you saw, it was in the appointment letter for all the groups.
Right.
And showing them that they had a Google Drive that they could use. There was an email distribution list. All meetings should be, you know, and on and on and on. So
it very well may be that neither of the three individuals want to come back for a whole host of reasons, but it's just that it's a courtesy to ask them if they, having been former members, if they want to go first. And then if not, then appointing Ms. Schroeder to be the...
Well, I'll come back. We'll see. We'll just ask.
But it could be an alternate because someone is showing interest to be a... You could say it could be an alternate position or a full time.
Also a good point.
Yeah.
Well, that's what I'm saying. If you want to continue the same pattern that you used for the ZBA, asking the alternate first, I'm okay with that. I'm just saying, before you send out a whole clearing call of the entire town to fill the alternate position, it might be nice if you ask one of the three people that are no longer members of the board if they want to come back, at least in an alternate capacity.
But well, the alternate was just recently put on, right?
We haven't appointed Jackie Schroeder. She's brand new.
Right.
And so I would prefer to ask them if they wanted to be a full member and say that we might also have an alternate that, as a full member. I think that that would be better.
Yeah, I'm fine with that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Are you okay with that, Mike?
I thought you were saying you were going to disappoint Ms. Schroeder, because she's an alternate now, to become the full position, and then we would have an alternate position open.
Yes.
So my suggestion was to ask one of the three people that are no longer members to be an alternate.
It is a good idea, but I would prefer not to ask them to be an alternate. I would prefer to ask them to be a full member.
Yeah.
So that's the only distinction.
I would think it's nicer to ask them to be a full member also, but I'm saying if you were going to do...
Well, it's what we do, and so I think we've pretty much, by consensus, have decided we would offer that full member. And say there could be an alternate position as well, but possibly not either. Okay, well, thank you for that. Let me just make sure my note, yeah, I did. Okay. So the election of chairs is proceeding. So the Conservation Commission will meet this week, ZBA that first week in May, and Michael will be handling the planning board. the rest are committees, I don't want to say that they're, the others are committees without the regulatory and statutory kinds of pieces, but is rec, did the rec committee, is the rec committee?
We haven't met since.
Alright, and the historical?
Met on last Thursday.
Okay.
Chris, I'm sorry, yes, Chris Benedetto was re-elected as chair.
Very good. Okay, and is Celia the secretary?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think the rec is the last Sunday of this month.
Alright, very good.
I will be there, so I can do that one.
Management response, I actually started that, I have no draft to show you, but I'm hoping that, if not next Monday, then when I come back from my trip. Quarter one budget report, so when I work on that, which I also do when I'm away, as soon as Caroline gives me the figures, there are two things, I'm going to work on. First is just the cost of potentially having a manager for the transfer station. And, but then the second one is a budget revision that we have to make for the payroll taxes for the highway department and the executive. Because we were not withholding FICA. We said this, this was, came up as a result of the audit.
Oh, right, I remember that.
Yes, so previously to our putting the highway department road agent on the retirement system, it just happened about a year and a half ago, the only folks we had were the police, who are class group two.
Right.
And the group two folks don't have FICA withdrawal.
Right.
Okay. So fast forward, or whatever, depending on where you are in this sequence of events, when we put Jeff on it, we treated him the same way. So we didn't charge FICA. And then when Caroline, which was last year, became full-time, we didn't charge her FICA either. And so the retirement, you know, there were no warning signals from anybody about any of this. And until Tom this year said, you know, you need to pay FICA. So last year's, so the 2016 will come out of fund balance for Tom. And this year, so we probably have already had two payrolls. We're just absorbing it. Mm-hmm. And the, even the employee share, because mm-hmm. they thought their fault and we didn't want to charge them. So we're covering the entire thing, those first, either one, possibly two payrolls. I met with the staff. Caroline, of course, is the one who helped unearth it, so she knew.
Mm-hmm.
I met with the highway department staff, and they understood, they were fine.
Mm-hmm.
You know, reduces their paycheck,
mm-hmm.
but it's their money, it's just going into, you know,
mm-hmm.
somewhere else for a short bit of time.
Mm-hmm.
But now we have to revise the budget for those positions, the payroll taxes in the executive and the payroll taxes in the highway department. So I need to calculate that.
So the reason why the police didn't have FICA removed is because they've got state retirement, is that correct?
They're group two state retirement.
Oh,
group
type of state retirement. Okay.
They have like almost 30%. We're putting in certainly more than 25. It could be 28%
okay.
for them. We put in 11 point something for the rest.
For the retirement.
For the retirement.
Retirement.
Yes.
Okay, so it covers.
So it's vastly different. So obviously they have more.
Okay.
I guess they have a bigger payout.
Yep. Okay.
And because of that, they're not earning Social Security wages when they're in this.
That is correct. That's correct.
But that's only the police. It would be the same for fire. If we had full-time fire, we don't. But
if you had
because they're group
yeah.
two. So
yeah.
they would be group,
yeah.
the safety, public safety folks.
They're all in the group
two. They're group two. Teachers, Caroline, highway department, are group one.
Everybody
yep.
is.
Okay.
And so we were supposed to be withholding.
I'm surprised I didn't catch that.
Exactly.
Oh,
hello.
My God.
Yes. Because, you know, clearly, we would have done what we were supposed to do. We always like to do what we're supposed to do.
Yeah.
So.
The IRS didn't catch that on.
No one.
Okay.
So I need
I
to. So I will need to revise the budget. I'll have to go raid contingency, and cover the payroll. I don't know how much it's going to be, but I'll be working on that. So I'm just letting you know. We've done the road contract, so we will go to the Woodlands proposal to clean up the entrance. So we've heard from Mr. Desch. Let me see if I can. Is it, how do you spell his name?
D E S C H, I think.
Yeah.
Was I right? D E S C H?
Mm-hmm.
And Joe. Well, did you see, I'm not gonna bring it up.
I saw his proposal.
Yes.
But we wanted to make sure that it's gonna be done before the, before the road work is.
So I don't think there's, I don't think we need to do this with a motion, but by consensus. Are we okay with the proposal that Joe, that the Woodlands submitted to us?
Absolutely.
So I will then send him an email tomorrow, say, the board is fine, we thank you, we appreciate your work. Just please coordinate with our highway department because the work really needs to be done before we do the road.
Now, if he's got a little, can, because I'm assuming that Woodlands is done first and then Robbins, but could it be flipped if it needed to have a couple of time or something?
I suspect that it's gonna happen the way that Pike thinks is the most efficient itself.
Okay.
And it's not gonna be long one way or the other.
Yeah.
They're in and out.
Right, yeah, they, especially if they hire a tree service or whatever they're gonna do.
The Woodlands?
Yeah, it's gonna be in and out.
Yeah, so for the Woodlands, that though, I don't, you know, you saw my email, it says, go ahead and tentatively schedule somebody. The board looked on this favorably, we haven't actually decided, we were waiting for your proposal. But they're looking on it favorably, so if you could tentatively start scheduling, that might be best, and then we can let you know for sure next Tuesday, tomorrow. So hopefully they will be able to get somebody in, and if we tell them that, you know, they really need to, there's heavy equipment, it has to be done before.
Right, yeah.
Before the road gets done. All right, so thank you, I will let them know. Let me just make a note of that. We have received the treasurer's report from Mr. Crozier. Are there any questions or comments? As you saw in my response to him, I did have a comment.
Yeah.
Oh, so.
Reparation?
Yes, so.
Oh, yes, I'm sorry.
Yes.
Yes.
So all of a sudden there appears in the listing of accounts, you know, the ones that I'm used to seeing, the hydro, the LUT, they use change tax, blah, blah, blah. It was recreation commission, almost recreation committee, almost 6,000. Just shy of 6,000. I said, what's this?
I thought that was the checking account that we just had closed.
No, that I knew that. That had like one, maybe two.
And it's not what money's going in for this online thing or anything? Because that's something different?
That's something different. That is entirely something different. It was on this. So I said, this never showed up on Beverly's treasurer's report. It never showed up on Tom's financial statement that I could see if he listed individual accounts. I looked at like other governmental fund balances or something on in the financial statement. I see hydro, I see LUT. Maybe he's got it included somewhere else because it actually probably would be part of regular government funds.
Mm-hmm.
So he possibly does know about it and it possibly is there, but individually, this is the first time I'd seen that.
Wow.
Which always like makes me roll my eyeballs like, how could this be? I'm going into my fifth year, sixth year, whatever it is. Fifth year, this is new. So Vern's going to do more research to see what is behind it.
And who signed up, who was the originators of it?
Yes, because is it part of some long forgotten Warren article and maybe it's restricted?
Okay.
So he's going to find out if it's restricted or not.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's the research he's going to do. If it's not restricted, he'll just drop it into the general fund.
And then
it will just
say this is offsetting.
It will,
if they have an override.
It won't be revenue, it will just augment fund balance to almost 6,000.
But at least you'll know if there's 6,000 there and if they don't have enough, we know that that's there to cover it, right? I mean, technically. No?
No, no, it's just gonna go into fund, no, 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 unless it's restricted, if it's restricted, then we have to see what it's restricted to, what its purpose is.
So even though it's red. Fund balance.
I know that, so there are clearly still some things about warrant articles that I'm not completely familiar with, because one of my first couple of years, Tom, the auditor, said, well, you've got this warrant article on beautification, you know, village beautification or something that has $4,000. And he asked the board, do you want to carry it forward? And he had a couple of things like that, and I said, huh? So Ed explained where it came from. It came from a warrant article. And I said, well, can you hang on, because can I ask the garden club? And so the garden club used $2,000, maybe $3,000 of it to put a fence. If you go down Cross Street, you know that walkway? There's a part of it that overlooks Second Street. And there was a drop off, you know, and so it was unsafe. So we put a fence there, and we used the money from that warrant article to do it. So, which, you know, usually these things are not supposed to continue on, it lapse.
Right.
So I don't know if there's some special magic associated with warrant that keeps it going, but in any event, so maybe it is attached to it, we'll have to see what Vern finds out.
Okay.
That was the only surprise that I saw about the treasurer's report. All right, endurance race got in. So right before the meeting, I did sign the final approval for that race. We'd already, the board before you had approved it. We hadn't signed that we had, so I signed that before. It is April 28th. I asked him if he could provide us with some PR that we could put on our website, and he gave me his link. So at some point, we'll put it up on the website. The next thing, legal invoice for planning. We got an invoice today from John Radigan, yeah, the Tucker, Chandela, and whatever it is. For training for the planning board.
Yeah.
And I was surprised by that.
So was I.
Because when we talked to John Krebs thought that John Radigan would be delivering this pro bono.
What he told us.
And John Krebs reiterated that today. He was sorry for the confusion, and he said if the board did not want to pay it, that he would cover it. So, personally, it's about $1,000. It's somewhere that they say it.
Yeah, well,
so,
I didn't
know, it's... The board obviously didn't authorize spending $1,000,
no.
Right? Because we thought it was pro bono.
It was a worthwhile training, we're doing that, but I don't know if we would have done.
So, do we want to just say, look, John, whatever, we didn't authorize this. Do we say, well, we didn't authorize this, but it was helpful, and we would pay half, which is roughly what we paying for the budget committee training.
What do we have budgeted for planning board assistance?
You probably can find it easier than I can. Yes. It's in a section on its own.
There is planning and zoning, planning consultants. So we have $6,500.
What did we spend last year?
I'm looking for that.
Should be the first column, I think.
$1,600 and change.
So we didn't.
It's a light year, so.
We didn't come close to spending
our
consultant fee. So.
I think we should take it out of it. Either way, even if he did, it's coming out of his pocket either way. So, if this would be, it would have been paid to him, planning consultant fees. So, I don't think we should take it from him.
So, you think we should cover the entire training?
I think it should come out of the consultant's fees. Yeah. That line is.
Denise,
I don't think he should pay for it himself. I mean,
it does. It seems a little
harsh.
Harsh.
Yeah.
I agree with that.
I think if they have money in their budget, we should pay for it out of the budget. But we should, going forward, make sure we have a clear understanding about any services that we receive.
Right.
I mean,
mean, at least John, at least he said, yes, I did think it was pro bono. The two of us thought it was pro bono.
He told us it was.
We had no PL, we didn't, you know.
And has anybody questioned the lawyer?
Yes, yes, he did.
No, I'm correct.
Yes, he, and he said that, and of course, this is not, what John, this is where the misunderstanding took place, because John thought he had talked to Attorney Radigan beforehand, but it was way beforehand, and now Attorney Radigan says, well, I don't, our firm doesn't do enough work with the town of Rollinsford to justify my doing pro bono work.
Radigan is our go-to person for the planning board for legal counsel.
For those kinds of matters, land, land use, I guess.
In the last several years that I've been on the planning board, we've called on him once, maybe twice.
I think last year, though, we had some legal fees associated with Shady Lane.
That, well, that's, those were, that's the, yeah. Those were the two times were around that, so. And before, no, and before, there was one other time when
Before the board used to.
Pat Macklin was chair.
Yeah, before my time, I think there were issues associated with current use or.
Oh, he's been the go-to person, but since I've been on, maybe three times.
Yeah.
So it's been.
All right, so, so then, is it the board's wish that I contact John Krebs and say, we will cover this invoice, we're gonna take it from the planning consultant line, and.
Yeah, I think that's.
And hope that we don't, you know, go over budget on that line. All right, I would be happy to do that. All right, thank you. This is just an announcement, as far as I know, we heard from our town clerk that on April 10th, which is tomorrow.
Yeah.
Marshwood students, I think it's the Marshwood slash Rollinsford high school students will be doing community service and trash pickup. We were not asked to do anything, so I think they have volunteers who will be overseeing it.
I think it's part of their community service for the high schools. So.
Yeah.
Great. Thank you.
All right. So I'm a bit in a quandary about the budget committee training. So it's, I asked the Municipal Association to preserve April 25th, tentatively speaking, until the Budget Committee met last week, and then I realized it didn't meet. So now I'm worried about losing the date, because I would also like to ensure that the training happened before the quarter one review.
Yeah, well, I think you need to make sure that you have a critical mass of the Budget Committee available to attend it.
I can send out a notice.
All right.
Why don't I send an out notice to the current people?
Thank you.
And
you should be able to just use Budget Committee.
Yeah. Yep. Is the new members on there?
Yes.
Okay.
Yep.
Yeah, I'll send it out and see if, you know, if people can do it. And
okay.
I think we should continue to do it that day.
We need to confirm. We were hoping to discuss it at the first BC meeting.
Right. Yep. Yep. So 6:30, right? Town
yes.
Hall.
Town Hall.
All right.
Yeah.
And,
you may also let them know that we're going to open it up to public who might be interested in serving in the future, as well as to our department heads, but they get first.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I'll
front row seats.
Okay. I'll send that out tonight or tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you. MapGeo is tomorrow night here at 6:30. I'll be here, so I'll introduce the topic and blah, blah, blah. And we've already had a couple of questions about, one from Joe Dash and Caroline, so about wanting more of the tax card related information to be part of it. Yeah, so I'll, I did send Rachel Mack, who's the SRPC person, I sent her that question. Yes.
We're over.
Yes. Okay, are we ready to call Chad?
I remember getting sent down here to talk about it. So
just to set the context, Chad recommended that, you know, he managed the abatement request right here, do it here.
Yeah.
And
because they,
so
they manage it anyways,
he can
but from
do
afar
it,
typically,
he
right?
He usually does it at the office, but
yeah.
This way he could meet with people if
yes.
he just so chose.
Was that his suggestion or Caroline's?
I believe it was his, as it turns out, yes.
I mean, it's more convenient for the resident that's requesting it.
If Chad, if it's helpful to talk to them, I thought they did this in, without contacting. All right, I'm going to put her on speakerphone here. You can get closer.
All around the cell phone.
Yeah.
Your call forwarded to an automated voice messaging system. (6-0-3-3-7-0-0-6-4-0) is not available. At the tone, please record your message. When you've finished recording, you may hang up or press 1 for more options.
Hi, Chad. This is Suzanne Hewitt from the Select Board. We're a little late in placing our phone call to you. If you are still available and want to call us back within the next half hour, please feel free. Otherwise, we'll try to reconnect maybe next Monday. Thanks, Chad. Bye. All right.
Do you kind of want to get just the consensus from us, and if they call you tomorrow, you can give them that decision?
Yes. So let me tell you my concern. Yeah. My concern was, is this going to use more contract hours? Because the contract is set up with a certain number of contract hours. We've never come close to using them, except this past year when we did come close. So Caroline, when I mentioned that, Caroline said it would be part of the, he doesn't see that that's an issue, that it would be the same one way or the other.
Okay.
So that was part of my...
Oh, you mean being here versus being in his office?
Yes.
Okay.
So that was one of my questions. Mm-hmm. And the other one was, you know, Caroline suggests, well, a board member could be there. I don't know that I don't want to spend a day sitting over his shoulder. So, but if it's a Monday that he does it and he wants to give us a report at meeting, or, you know, a quick email report or something, then that's fine. But if this allows, I guess I would support it if in fact it allows him to better serve the residents.
Right.
If in fact, you know, it means that he might be able to call somebody, invite somebody in.
Mm-hmm.
It's a good idea.
Yeah, I agree. If it doesn't interfere with the scope of
our contract. So
I'm okay with it. As long as he can do his job here,
he's got the same. Well, he sees the tax card.
Yeah. Okay.
And then the rest. I mean, he's got a computer in there that's connected to the internet.
Yeah.
And he may have his own laptop. Blah, blah, blah.
Right.
So he'd be doing whatever searching. I'm guessing.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, but
why
I will.
Not?
That's
a
good question.
Because he would come in. He comes. The light system.
No.
All right. Rough night. In the past, he's come in to give us a report.
Well, in the past,
on certain cases.
On certain cases, not all of them. So normally, one of the process that seems to work that we've seen be most conventional. Hi, Chad.
Hi, how are you?
I'm well. How are you?
I'm doing great. Sorry, don't usually answer calls. I'm in the unknown, and then I get to listen. I'm like,
I came in as unknown. That's odd. Most people know who's calling, so that's too bad. Well, anyway, in the few short minutes it took you to call us back, I mean, the board is generally in favor of your proposal to spend like a day here to work on abatements.
Mm-hmm.
Our concern was as follows. Would this, do you see this as adding more contract hours, and would we be in danger of bumping up against the maximum contract hours?
No, because my plan is to do all the business there that I would normally be doing at the office. So it's really just switching my location. So you shouldn't see any change there. It actually might even, the business might get done in a quicker period of time because I'm not being interrupted when I would normally be at the office.
Mm-hmm.
And then I'm thinking that those are the days that Caroline can actively set appointments. So if normally someone comes in and she tells
So we've, yeah, we find that to be very attractive because, you know, if your ability to meet with individual property owners would be a good customer service. So, so the board is, yeah.
That's what I'm thinking, and I think they'll like to, you know, at least get face to face and have an actual appointment rather than, waiting for an email back that might take me a while to get to.
Right, but still, the abatement, your recommendation, it still comes to us as a recommendation, correct?
Abatements would always come to us, absolutely.
So you might be able to tell them what you were going to recommend, but then it comes to us, which is what I was starting to remind the board about that process. So it would come to us. Either you would deny the abatement, or you would say, yes, I've listened to the property owner, and yes, we will shave, you know, $1,000 off the assessment or whatever it is, correct?
Yep.
And then we would either agree with either of those. So.
Correct. Yes. So basically, what happens is I already have the abatement. I will write up a letter of recommendation, which is either I deny the abatement based on, you know, these issues or what I found, or I grant the abatement based on these issues and this is the value change. And then you guys decide based on my recommendation whether to agree with it or if there needs to be more clarification before you guys decide.
Okay. Yep. Okay. So I think. So we think it's a great idea.
Yeah, I think it will work well. We're doing it in some of our other towns, and it's worked really well because they can now fill up a full day, and it's nice because I'm there, so I can help out with other things that they might have been, you know, waiting on their desk for me to come up for a random day. So.
All right. So do you know when you might be here for the first day?
I don't have it set up yet.
All right. Okay. I was just curious.
Do you guys normally meet on Mondays?
We do. Yes, the board does, unless it's a holiday.
So I'll try to, if it's okay with you, I'll try to set it up with a Monday.
Yeah.
Okay. Like one, you know, maybe the first Monday of every month going forward. And then that way, if I do need to stay for a meeting or something like that, I will already be there.
Yep. All right. I think that sounds good.
Very helpful.
I've seen lots of nods from the board, so I think we're in agreement, Chad, and I think it's a great idea, so thank you for suggesting it.
All right, no problem. I'll set it up with Kevin.
Super. All right. Have a nice evening.
Yeah, good evening, guys.
Yep. Bye. Did you catch what you needed to catch?
I think so.
Okay. All right, so that's a great idea. I'm sorry we waited so long to call. Oh, SRPC. So do you remember last week when I was talking about Cynthia Copeland's retirement as executive director of SRPC?
Yes.
It was something I wanted to tell the board,
yes.
And I couldn't remember it. I remember. It had nothing to do with Cynthia, which is probably why I couldn't remember it. So when Cynthia came to visit us, and we talked, or I brought up the village and infrastructure and the roads and sidewalks and that, she says, well, you know, you should probably have, the town should probably have an idea of what it wants to do in the village. And I heard it, and I heard it, and I went, oh, because it's like its project. But at the retirement party, I saw James Burdine, I'm not sure his last name, he's the economic developer.
Oh, right.
Really nice man. So I said, James, can I sit down with you and talk business for a bit? And so I asked him, if the town were going to entertain doing something like this, how would we go about finding somebody to help us do this? And so they said that, he said, so you would customarily write an RFP, which is kind of what we did for space needs several years back. Write an RFP and, you know, put it out for bid. And I said, okay, that's a good idea. The issue is we're going to need some help to write that kind of an RFP because we don't even know what to put for in such a thing. And he said, I said, could SRPC, you know, obviously for a fee, could SRPC help us with that? He said, well, yes, we could. So the problem is that if it means that we can't respond to the RFP, then we probably don't want to do that because we want to be able to bid on the RFP. And so I was reminded though of Will Tanner, and they work with vendors, contractors, when they're setting up their infrastructure RFPs, because they want to make sure that the sort of guidelines they're putting for how much they think things will cost, that they bear some resemblance to reality.
Right.
And I said, so, well, if you're working with that contractor, Aaron, is that contractor allowed to bid in the RFP? Yes, because you're still going to give it to the best bidder, right? You still, so I don't know, I would check with the Municipal Association though on that, and maybe there's something about this kind of an RFP. But so anyway, I just had that conversation, I didn't do anything. We could invite James to speak with us if we wanted to just hear more about what the project, not about this RFP thing, but what would such a project look like? And because first of all, we'd want to be convinced that this was something good, you know. I mean, clearly, I don't know if it's clearly, but I think it would probably have to be something that would be on a warrant article, you know, that would go to the voters like this space needs. So, I mean, I'd be happy to invite James if we thought we wanted to have that kind of a conversation, just a very preliminary beginning conversation about that.
When are we scheduled for our road?
So,
yes,
it is 2020.
Okay.
So, might we need to push it forward a little bit if we don't have enough, you know, because these things sometimes take time to roll themselves out.
Right.
Then we'd have to look at the road plan and do it. So, 2019 is the completion of Robert's farm and a Jesse Doe overlay.
Yep.
That's what's currently listed.
On the schedule.
Yeah. And then the following year, it's the village, including sidewalks
potentially.
Potentially.
Right.
And so that's what prompted the question, and now nothing is simple.
Well, if we're really hoping to do the village in 2020 or 2021, this makes the most sense to me, to make sure that we have this visioning session.
Well, it would allow us to, you know, if part of it, you know, if we need to make some pedestrian, you know, if we're trying to increase economic activity in the village, and certain infrastructure would help. Well, now's the time, you know. So
right. Well, exactly. If there are inefficiencies, it's better to fix them when you're rehabbing than to rehab and then go, oh, why didn't we fix this when we had the opportunity to fix it?
Exactly. It just makes, you know, a project that you thought was like this look like this.
No, fair enough. But, I mean,
but in the final analysis, it does make it better.
There are telephone poles in the middle of the sidewalks in the village. It makes no sense to redo sidewalks that are useless. I mean, that's part of the process.
Yes.
That's kind of wonderful.
I talked to Cynthia, too. Cynthia Coppola, who lives in Newmarket in the Mills.
Yes. Sure.
And with some of her neighbors who live there, too. And you know, Newmarket has just done an amazing job if you haven't been down there.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, one of the things they decided to do was to put the utilities underground.
Sure.
And so, you know, this is one of those kinds of things where the town, to the extent that we can get the town engaged, I mean, this is,
right,
you know.
That's what I think needs to happen.
Exactly. So it's what does the town think?
Could happen with the downtown. Sure.
Yeah, exactly. Should this be a center of development activity for us?
Mm-hmm.
And there are things, this didn't come up with James, but I, from talking to Chad and doing some research, there are things that we can do from a property tax perspective to sort of create a little fund to help I think it's TIF. Are you familiar with TIF?
I am.
A little bit. So I'm not going to be able to explain it correctly, but it provides the ability to freeze the property taxes that we get from a certain area, let's say the village, and anytime when the property tax that's actually returned to us because values are going up is higher, that gets put into this TIF account. I'm simplifying it greatly,
mm-hmm.
but and it can be used for like things like sewer improvements, water improvements, you know, the kinds of infrastructure things, underground utilities.
Yeah, it's all for
something like that.
Yeah.
So, all right.
And it's a way of doing it instead of asking for direct tax.
It's another sort of
taxation
way to sort of redirect some property tax. Any increase in your property taxes gets redirected. It kind of says it's going to go right back into the
instead of saying, okay, well, we want an additional warrant for X.
So a lot has to be understood before we get anywhere near that. But to have an initial conversation that I will, I'm not feeling any particular rush, so I'll just, but I will contact him and get that. I think it's Burdine, I'm just not sure.
Well, there's economic activity going on now with the redevelopment of the Blue Wind building.
Mm-hmm.
There's businesses within the mill that are expanding or want to expand. So this is a good time.
Yes, and absolutely. And so we, key people, key stakeholders to bring into that would be Jeff Apsey, the Pelerins, exactly right.
Some of their tenants, sure.
Some of their tenants, precisely.
And residents.
Yeah,
for sure.
Absolutely.
People who live.
Yeah, and people who don't, but who have some understanding or some interest in,
yeah,
in seeing the town move in a certain direction.
Well, yeah.
All right. Ordinance. I don't know why this is still there.
You wanted
me
to read it.
Oh, did you read it?
I did.
Oh, do you have anything to say?
Yeah. I do, actually.
Thank you for remembering what.
Yep.
I'm
pulling
there.
It up there. So our hawkers and peddlers
ordinance
requires a license.
A registration and a license. Is there a fee associated?
No, there is. It's a $100 fee.
Yeah.
And or you can have a temporary one for, I think it's like $10 a week or is it? But I mean, there's a whole list of things that are on our application. We have one, two, my screen won't move down. Six, seven, eight different things that are supposed to be on this application that I'm pretty confident is non-existent in our files. I don't think we actually have one. But
What do you mean?
Like a physical application that people have to fill out.
Right. You don't think we actually received an application?
I don't believe we have an application to give out to people to fill out.
No, there was something associated with it. A permit application.
I understand that there's a requirement for one, but do we have the actual application?
Yes, I thought there was one.
It's not part of the ordinance. So.
It was on the paper that Chief Ducharme brought up, because I saw it. It was a one sheet. He brought upstairs, you know, when I was...
During the day?
During the,
okay.
Not lap, whenever this first came up, maybe lap,
okay.
Beginning.
So he does have a form, though. Okay.
I believe so. I'm looking to see whether that gets scanned as part of this.
I didn't see it. It's not part of the link that...
Right.
I only just sent the scanned copy of the ordinance, but it's pretty detailed.
Maybe it is...
Whether they're residents or not, they have to have a permit. So.
Yeah. So here it is. I don't know if the thing is.
Is
no,
it?
You're right.
Like
it's
the,
not here, but I did see it.
Okay. Well,
so one does exist. I feel quite sure that I saw it. It should be there on the website. We'll have to get...
There's definition section. It's a pretty detailed ordinance.
Does anything seem amiss to you? Does it seem like...
Well, the fines, the penalties aren't in check with our...
Our current ones?
Our current ones. So we Bob to take a look at that. So just make sure that he's only recommended the others.
So check the fine. No.
And how it's administered.
Need to review a permit application.
Yeah, and make sure it's still
okay.
Current.
So as this rolls out, when we feel we're, yeah, this
and
is.
And I did not go back. I didn't cross-reference the RSAs to make sure they're still applicable. So
okay.
We really need to do that. But I mean, it's.
Well, we can have the municipal association take a look at that.
Sure, for sure. But it's a pretty detailed ordinance. It's supposed to do it annually. And it's interesting. It's not. They don't have to be peddlers. They don't have to be like itinerant peddlers. I mean, they can be.
It's like this Comcast person, theoretically.
Right.
You know, I never heard back from Comcast, by the way.
Sure.
Yeah, I don't know. That just doesn't sit right.
So, just saying. Denise, you have a question?
Do we have a book of where all the ordinances are in the subdivision?
In theory, they're not all in there apparently.
So this is one of the deficiencies of municipal government that we are aware of and became painfully aware of when we first got on the board. So, but I can tell you that the town clerk is the keeper of the paper ordinances.
By statute.
By, yes, thank you, Michael, by statute. So she was one of the, you know, so when we got this email from the resident, we do have a Google Drive called ordinances.
Okay.
So the ones, there's a README file there. The README file states clearly these are not all of them.
Okay.
These are the ones that have come to us electronically that we've worked on, but we are in the process of trying to put them all electronic there,
mm-hmm.
but they're not all there. So, but I've also knew that Chief Ducharme had some on his, the police website, and he's the one who said, yes, there is some. So I thought, I expected to see it there, and I didn't. So I said, it's not there, it's not ours, and Kate said she didn't have it, at least at first she said that. And so, and then that the Monday, must have been last Monday, Bob came up with the ordinance in his hand and included the application. I said, all right, can we, can, and then Kate came in and said, it was in the second binder, I did find it.
Oh, okay.
And it's signed, so that's always a good thing too,
mm-hmm.
signed by the board.
Okay.
So it is a project. I mean, should they, I mean, I would like to see them all online. They should, everybody,
right.
and just one, just Google Drive, and then the police can point to that one, so that they're not in two different places.
Right.
We just have our ordinances. So the ones that we are working on ourselves are in good order and are on the drive. It's these old ones that have not made it there yet. So, Michael, you're about to say something.
These vendors or peddlers, depending on how they're selling their goods, whether from a push cart or from a motor vehicle, but it's on public land. So for instance, we have the endurance race?
Yes.
If they have a food truck that's there, this food truck should be licensed to
mm-hmm.
be a vendor in our town.
Mm-hmm.
And like the open studios, if they
yeah,
have a food truck there, or an ice cream truck, or whatever they have,
yeah.
it should
falls.
Be a vendor. If the ice cream truck comes to Rawlinsford, which it does in the summertime, it should be registered as a vendor or peddler in the town of Rawlinsford.
So we wouldn't have to do that. We would have to notify them that they need to do that with the police department, correct?
Yeah, it's handled. I think
the police.
Yes, we don't.
So if we have someone who is like a ice cream truck or something for family day, for instance.
Oh yeah.
They need to go and register that they're going to be there that day with
right.
the people.
Okay.
So
okay.
It's only $10. So.
Oh, all right.
Well, then it's worth it for them if they're gonna.
Yeah.
yeah I mean,
right.
okay. So I didn't know that. So.
All right.
Good
fair
to know.
Enough.
I didn't know that.
Good to know.
So we have. I mean, there are exemptions. So
what are the exemptions?
Hold on, let me get to that.
You know what, Linda?
Maybe
a
non-profit.
Because Linda
yeah.
Watson did the ice cream slushy thing, and she filed with the police department. So,
They must not be the only town, right?
Yeah,
and they.
So non-commercial vendors, such as religious, charity, political, or other social non-profit organizations are exempt. So like Family Fun Day.
Well,
no.
But
is
your,
it,
but
no.
your, yes. Participants in a street fair as defined, which may be authorized from time to time by the board, shall be exempt from the requirements of Section 8 only. That's what Section 8 is.
So
you're not required to have your New Hampshire hawkers and peddlers permit. That's a state permit, too, they're supposed to have. But you would still, there would just be one master.
And you have
permit.
To have insurance, which
yeah.
she did and then got a copy.
Okay.
So that was
so like Family Fun Day to me would be
yeah.
a street fair.
Mm-hmm.
So you would, as the host, compile a list of all, like if you had, I don't know, you usually only have the one ice
yeah.
truck there,
yeah.
ice cream truck.
Well, the Garden Club is a vendor actually, but we would be
but
a non-profit
not,
within the street
vendor,
fair.
So you
would
not
yes.
qualify.
So, yeah.
so
yeah.
there's a whole host
we
of
don't
things
need
that
to worry right. about it.
Yeah.
But the annual fee to operate as a peddler in the town is $100. A license to operate as a peddler on a temporary basis shall be $10 per week for a maximum of period not to exceed.
So don't you want to put a prompt at this? Because ordinances
usually.
Are always prompted by something.
Yeah. And any person or a firm or corporation violating it is subject to a violation and a fine of $100.
Well, I would like to take a look at the whole thing myself, so let's keep it on the agenda.
Yes, please.
And think about that.
I don't know.
Do you know where to find it, Denise?
The ordinance?
Yeah.
I'll go and look.
Yeah, it's on the drive. What's not there, though, is the permit application, so I'll try to see if I can.
Send it to both of you.
Yeah, get it.
Okay.
All right.
I have to go back and look myself.
All right, so that's it. I'm tabling the SRPC grant application. Town meeting postponement, is there any, do we still need this on the agenda?
No.
I mean, you can keep it on just so I remember to give you updates as the bill rests and you want, but you don't have to, you can take it off. I mean, it's got to pass, I don't know.
All right. The initial conversation regarding meeting twice monthly, we'll just visit it periodically, we're tabling it today. Oak Street boundary, Michael's offered to do that, we'll just keep this until the perambulation does happen.
Am I supposed to?
Yes, you would offer it, you said.
No, I want to do it, that's not the issue. I don't remember, am I supposed to contact Dover to?
No, you do it on your own, you do it on your own. This is not a joint perambulation.
Well, we're not doing a joint one, no.
No.
So you want me to go for a walk by myself?
Yeah, and find the markers and make sure that they bear some resemblance to what we decided upon.
Does that work, I mean?
Perambulate?
Yes, please.
Means to walk.
Oh, couldn't you just walk to walk?
It's an old colonial term, so this is like the vestige of colonial days.
Okay.
When actually boards, select boards, boards of selectmen, because that's what they were, they would walk, they were, the state asked them to walk their boundaries once every 7 years. So you would walk, you know, so that's what Mike just said. So when they were all towns, the, you know, town A and town B would agree to walk the boundary.
I thought we were doing it with Dover, so.
No, Mike, Kevin, you can check in with Kevin. It's Kevin Bound who was sort of overseeing this.
Look at that email again, I'm just feeling this.
And it's called.
Well, it warms up a little bit, if you don't mind, I'd like it not to go over 30 hours.
About 3 years ago, the New York Times had an article about perambulation. You know, it was one of these human interest kinds of things. They say, well, you know, it's still done in, you know, some towns in New England, blah, blah, blah. And one of my cousins read it. He says, so do you perambulate? I said, well, as a matter of fact, we've got something in the works right now.
All righty.
All right. So, that's it for the agenda. We'll go to standing items. So, board member activities and updates. It's a busy week, I think. The Conservation Commission is meeting Thursday. There's the Map Geo tomorrow night. And there's the public information session on bees and beehives on Wednesday at the library associated with the community garden.
Yeah.
What time is that?
That is at 7 in the community room. So at 6:30, we're doing an orientation for the people who are renting new beds for the first time and doing a seed swap. But at 7 o'clock is the talk
on
bees.
You said the library?
Library, in the community room, yeah. So that's sort of my...
What time was that Map Geo?
Map Geo is here at 6:30. Here. I don't imagine we're going to get towards.
I have a course with them, sorry.
Yeah, I'm going to be at a grade school play.
I will be here. Are you going to the...
My granddaughter's in a play at the grade school tomorrow night. So
here?
Yeah. In grade school.
What are they doing?
Second grader.
Is it Peter Pan or something?
Well, that was over the weekend. This is a classroom play.
Oh.
Yeah, so.
Okay, no worries. All right, so that's it for activities this week.
Yeah,
so, building permits?
Last week I went to a TAC meeting, I've got to tell you about it.
Oh, yeah.
That's the presentation.
So, well, let's say it for Denise. I'm shaking my head, but Denise is not familiar with it, so.
So, as part of Stratford Regional Planning, they have. Technical assistance committees that deal with transportation issues, and I have been voluntold to attend, and I have been off and on, so I went this past week. They are working on an MOU with how many regional planning commissions? 5, I believe, and Coast and Bus and Wildcat Transportation and the Federal Department of Transportation and the State Department of Transportation on deliverables for different projects. So that's still in the works, so they showed us the first draft, so. And then we had a presentation by the Department of Environmental Services on what municipalities can do to encourage electronic vehicles in your town. First of all, we should be converting our fleet over to over to electronic vehicles.
I'd be happy to do that. Are they going to have to fund that?
Well, first of all, I laughed at the notion of fleet, because the fleet they showed was not a fleet that any small town has, let's just say that.
It was a real fleet.
Another fleet. It was like the city of Manchester has, or the University of New Hampshire has, and it wasn't, anyways, it was an admirable goal for sure. But then to set up charging stations, and if you're doing infrastructure upgrades anyways.
Well, that's, you know, that's interesting because.
It makes sense to do that, but.
You know, something like that could come out in talking about, you know, the downtown district.
Sure.
Right?
Perhaps, sure. But, and that is what they talk about, like Durham, which is a different animal for sure than Rollinsford, but Durham does have one now by the university, not associated with the university, but.
And Tesla is, you know, some companies are funding some of these.
Some of them are, yeah. So that was actually an interesting thing, actually, that if you get someone else to pay for it, even better. I mean, they're not necessarily encouraging us to spend our own money. It's to go for these grants. But Tesla doesn't have the same type of charging station as all the rest of them, apparently. But anyways. What else did they talk about? The one thing they didn't talk about, and I wanted to bring it up, but I just sat there and smiled and didn't run into the skunk in the Indian patch, but where do they make up the lost funding to the highway fund by switching to electronic vehicles? Because it's still wear and tear on the roads, but you're not getting the benefit of a
so how was the how was the block grant determined?
Anyways.
I thought it was by the mileage of town maintained roads that we get.
Yes, the state grant you get, yes, but the state gets their money from the road toll, also commonly known as the gas tax.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's every time you fill up your car, right? Any of us fill up our car, we pay a tax.
Yes.
That's the road toll. And that money goes back to the state for highway.
I see. So there would be a loss.
There already is for people like me that drive highways.
Right.
So.
Is there an answer? But,
I didn't ask the question because they were just so happy with themselves talking about how we all need to switch. Well, where do we make up the lost revenue?
Well, several years back, maybe even 5 years, there was an op-ed piece in the New York Times by someone from the University of Texas Austin, I think,
mm-hmm.
responding to this very thing and how do you make things fair? Because you know, a vehicle that is a hybrid or whatever is still using the road.
Correct.
And so this person said, so if, you know, everybody, every state has inspections, right? They may vary.
No, you know, not every state does have inspections, I don't think, actually.
Well, let's assume something like that.
Most do, I think.
So, but there would be some point where, let's say if there is an inspection or some other thing where you would have your mileage recorded.
Yeah.
It's not supposed to fiddle around with your odometer.
Right.
So, you know.
Right.
Point A, your odometer was this, now a year later it's that, it's 10,000
miles. I didn't bring it up with them because that wasn't, they're the Department of Environmental Services, they're worried about clean
right.
air, and I agree with them on that aspect. But we're there at the TAC meeting where all we talk about is getting money into the county for projects. Well, you're actually, this is one of the funding sources you're actually depleting the fund for.
I'm saying there's another way to manage it, that's all.
I
yes.
agree with you, I didn't bring
there
it up
are other responses.
It's not their purview. I just thought it was
all
funny
right.
that they were coming
so
to us to talk about it.
We'll stop that conversation.
Sure.
And is it a big group, Mike?
TAC?
Yeah.
Every town is represented, plus the university and city,
okay.
Within
the within
regional.
The
so it's
or the
from Brookfield up in Carroll County down to Newmarket and Rockingham County and all of Stratford County. And it's one other town in Rockingham. Northwood might be in it.
Well, they're on the commission, so.
In the Regional Planning Commission? Then,
yes.
Okay. So it's not just Stratford County,
all right.
My point. I mean, it's more of a region, but because we're the bulk of the. And the university has a person separate from Durham, and Coast Bus is represented. Separate from whatever town.
They're everywhere.
Right, well, everywhere.
All right.
Bus.
Yes. All right, want to do your folder?
First building permit this evening is 2018-022, 216 Summersworth Road. We asked, we had a couple questions for Mr. Clark about wetlands, and he says that he has reviewed it, and it is delineated on the plan. He's now highlighted for me, so we can see it. But there are no jurisdictional wetlands that are impacted within the zone that it is being built on. So it's also in the industrial zone. I have the same recollection that you had, that when this property owner, well, two previous owners, actually,
yeah,
I believe, wanted to tear the house down and build a new house. That was before the fire and everything else that happened. I told them that, you know, you only build it on the same footprint. Well, that wasn't necessarily what the zoning ordinance says, apparently. And that's what we were going by.
Yeah, so that's the last information that we had heard.
Right. So it's in the industrial zone, that part. And it's a single family home, so it's allowed. So
okay.
Right. It's not impacted. So the point is, we should be signing.
We can sign
the
it in good,
so
good,
it
conscience.
Was, the fee is $2,125.
This was a case, though, where we had some previous information.
Yeah, it may have been misinformation. Next permit is 2018-026, 505 Stockdale Circle. They're putting up a shed. Fee is $75. This is just a notice to all tax collectors. Please complete and return this form to the Board of Tax and Land Appeals no later than May 1st, 2018. In accordance with the provisions of RSA 76:13, the tax collector shall notify the Board of Tax and Land Appeals in writing of the date on which the final tax bill was sent. Complete this information below indicating the date of mailing of the final tax bills covering taxes which were committed to you on the original property warrant for 2017. For the period of April 1, 2017 through March 31, 2018. The bill is sent semi-annually, and it was final tax bills were mailed on November 10th, 2017. And this was just a copy.
So Andrea signed that and sent
Andrea
it off.
Has sent it off
so
to the state.
So this is an FYI to us.
Just for us.
Thank you.
This is our copy, just so we're aware that it was taken care of.
Did you want to see that?
No.
Does he need to have
yeah,
those
two? Yeah, I need
those guys. Yep. Thank you.
All right.
Okay. There's some things.
Do I say names and stuff?
You can just say the addresses. I say, are these like compliance things?
Yeah.
I say the addresses.
Just the addresses.
There's no address on it.
No address?
Yeah. Well, there's one here that there's no address on it, and there.
It doesn't
for the
refer
second
to property?
Driveway. Second
oh, it's 402 so, Stockdale Circle. Is it
on
it?
No. Oh, I'm sorry, there it is.
Okay.
Sorry, I was looking up here.
Yep, sorry.
It's for 402 Stockdale Circle, about the second driveway. And this is from a letter from Suzanne asking for them to get in contact with us.
Oh, okay, this is when you just, someone discovered and told us there
yep.
was a second driveway, and
right.
we asked Tom to write a letter. Quite likely the above activity at least requires a building permit. Okay, so I'll sign the letter.
Mm-hmm. Okay, the next one is for address 668 Silver Street, renovations, also thinking that they require a burning building permit on work that's been done on their property. A letter signed by Suzanne.
Okay.
All right.
Yes, I just gave it, but I don't know, it was here, so I don't
think.
There's
two on here. Okay. Let me know if I'm doing too fast. fast, huh? Okay, this is for address 234 Summersworth Road.
Is that the same one? Is that the building permit?
No, 216.
They're talking about the recreational vehicle that is being currently occupied on that property. And this is a letter coming from Thomas Clark, aware that these conditions are in violation of section 6 of the zoning ordinance of the town of Rollinsford. And they're giving them 15 days to discuss this issue and just establish a schedule of compliance.
Okay, so that's directly from Tom?
Yes, it is.
Okay, so I don't, you don't need to sign that. Okay, so that's an FYI.
It's an FYI.
This was the agenda article up at the top.
Yep.
We've been asking him to look at this.
Right, yeah. And this one also is from Thomas Clark. As a result of a compliant site inspection, the subject property was conducted 59 through 61 South Street. Observed during the inspection was a recreational vehicle that was currently being occupied. And there again, quoting violation of section 6, and that he has 15 days to notify them. So we just have to say we're okay with that going out.
Just an FYI, he's already sent it. He's just
letting us know. Oh, it's not signed. Oh, okay.
We asked him to take care of this.
Chamber Channel serving Summers of Rollinsford, Berwick, Northbrook, and Southbrook. It's just like a newsletter that goes out.
Okay.
Just if anybody wants to take a peek at it. Yeah. What's with Naval Shipyard Economic Impact 2017? I don't know what I'm supposed to say about the Shipyard Association.
Okay, so we do support the Shipyard Association. We give them $500 because of the number of people.
$100.
He's right, $100.
Okay, so they tell us.
They give us a report.
The annual payroll in Rollinsford.
What is it?
Annual for Rollinsford is $5,814,170, and there's 71 employees from Rollinsford.
Yeah.
The two of them.
There you go.
Part of the in case of the BRAC, the BRAC process will happen.
Yep.
Yeah.
So in case we're on.
Yeah. So that's
what
why we're saying.
We like to file that.
And we like to receive them because, you know, we're more apt to continue to give money if they tell us what the economic impact is, how many people it. In this case, it's economic impact, but for the community assistance, how many people have you helped from Rollinsford?
Right. Yeah. So that's good. This is the insurance service office. This is a letter to you, public fire protection.
Oh, can I see that
yes,
for just
absolutely.
A minute? I think Caroline.
This one? Sure.
All right, so this is just that it's notifying us that we're in insurance class 69 or 6-9. Can I read this a little bit? The last, so they're going to conduct a survey on public fire protection. The last survey was in 1993 in Rollinsford. We would like to update our information to verify the current insurance class 6-9, or 6/9. We're sending forms to the fire department. So they're asking the fire department to complete the survey, mm-hmm. and this information can be easily filled in by people in your departments. At their own convenience. So, do you have any post-its?
It's in my desk.
Well, that's all right. Well, I'll just put, please forward along to the RFD if they haven't received their own copy.
Okay.
Someone CC'd on the bottom there. Who is it?
Mark Rutherford. I'll just complete
it. I can see the CC.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. I'll just put it in there.
Okay, this one here is a purchase order 1416 to Mailways for the tax collector. This is for 1,100 postage property tax bills, July of 2018, for $418, one-time setup fee, $150, print, fold, insert, meter, and mail property tax bills, $144, and bills to Manchester Post Office. For the total of $747. It says this is town cost for postage is $545, so cost to the town for mail service is $202. I don't, that doesn't make sense to me.
All right, so I do have a little background information, these are my notes on top here. So I asked, I saw this, I saw that it was going to be in our folder, I asked Andrea. So this is a proposal to, what I would say, sort of professionalize the preparation and mailing of tax bills. So up to now, the tax collectors had to, you know, assemble some volunteer stuff and whatever, and use our own postage. So if you, there is a one-time setup fee. If you remove the one-time setup fee and the amount of hourly wages that we would be paying our tax collector for the extra time that she spends on these things, it's a savings to the town, an overall savings, because the postage being charged by mailways is less than what the town pays.
Okay. But so, you know, however they use
it. Yeah, whatever, however they do it. So this one-time setup fee, we probably are still saving money even with that, because it doesn't count the savings in the tax collector's hourly rate.
What about the news? Oh, you finished, I'm sorry. What about the newsletter?
No, that's a good question.
Can you stuff that in?
Yes, they will. Yes. They include that.
Oh, they'll include
that.
It too?
They include that, right. So they
what
talk.
What about the tax that, don't they sometimes put, they haven't already been paid, what is
the head tax. Call it, the resident
that's
tax.
That's different.
But did they have mailed them with the property tax bills before.
They have, and auto renewals now, I think, is what they're putting them in now.
They're putting them in auto renewals.
Okay.
You're right, though.
Thank you.
Absolutely right.
Previously, before they were doing it online.
So,
okay.
So here's
the tax bill, I think. Yeah, you're right.
So, because we still have some tax forms, we will actually be printing them and bringing them to Manchester for this. So, for maybe this run, if we decide to do this, maybe December. But afterwards, the output that comes from the tax collector software that Andrew uses to print these would just go directly, she would
send a file
over to this firm. So we would be saving also the printing of the forms because we wouldn't be using our own tax forms.
Sure.
In the meantime, we're going to use the ones we have because it would
sure.
be waste. And I think...
How much do we spend annually on the forms?
It's probably wrapped up in printing and copying. So. I don't know directly, but obviously...
Well, again, it's an additional savings.
It's an additional savings.
All right, well.
So, you know, we would be spending $545 for postage. So the cost of the town, if you just looked at the difference between $545 and this, would be $202. But $150 of that is a one-time setup cost. And it doesn't include the savings in Andrea's hourly... amount of extra hours that she spends to get all of this out. So those are, there's the cost of the envelopes that we wouldn't be, there's the cost of printer toner, because, you know, when we stop printing them ourselves. So there are other small little things. And
the net savings of the town, I think.
In the final analysis, it is a net savings, not except for this
the
first
time.
I think even that, if we did an analysis of Andrea's time, we might have it. But certainly after this first time, there would be a net savings.
So what happens with the time that she's been allocated for in her salary to do this position? How does that show a savings? Does she do something else, or does she just
so
get
when
reduced
we,
hours?
When we, no, she would have reduced number of hours, because when we do her, we do the budget, it is based on so many hours week, I don't remember exactly what it was, no, I turned this off for the time, so many hours per week, plus an additional 10 or 15 hours that are tacked on, and it's for this sort of thing. So you take those, let's say, 10 hours, and we would not be paying them. So it would not be replaced with something else, unless we chose to add something to her duties.
So her hours are going to be reduced to be able to do this, by a certain amount?
Yes.
In order to do this?
Yes.
Additional savings.
Yes, which is not, all she did was reflect the actual postage.
So, I have one more question about, I think it's great, actually, going to save resources. What about, so the newsletter, do we still have to have it printed and then we send it to them, or do we send them in the file? So we still have to...
We're going to be printing it. Now, in the future, maybe, I don't know, in the future they're going to print the tax bills, so I don't know the answer to that question.
Right.
But they will be, right now, this go-around, we will be printing the tax bills.
But even with, okay, well, that's okay.
And printing the newsletter, but they will be stuffing and.
But we still see that as savings, as still reflected in the savings? Or separate from the, that's separate from the tax bill, okay. I'm not against that, but it's separate from what you've described, so. There's still a cost to send out the newsletter either way, it's just, but it's just printing. It's still gonna be part of that, this postage, so that's fine, alright. So we just have to get the, this year, we just have to get the newsletter and the tax bills to them this one time.
Yes, and Andrea said that she would do that.
Okay.
Here's the, they work on towns, they do towns that are smaller than ours, they do towns, of course, that are bigger than ours. If you wanna see any of this.
Not really, you've done a breakout there, I can see though, I can't see it from.
Yeah, I mean, Andrea did this, right, yeah.
Yeah, it makes sense.
And these were just some additional cost savings that aren't reflected, this is just the postage savings.
I'm all in favor of saving resources and well, time is a resource, so.
Time is a resource.
Yeah, let's do it.
And the turnaround, particularly, I asked her this too, so would they go out faster? And she said that it would be most helpful at the end of the year, because that tax bill, I mean, usually the tax rate is late. We're trying to get them out so that people are not having to pay their tax bill on, you know, December 24th.
Right, exactly.
Or December 26th.
Right.
So it would be particularly helpful, it's like a 3-day turnaround. Right. And often it's a 4-day turnaround here anyway,
mm-hmm.
and maybe at the end of the year a little bit more. So that was the other, thing. So if you know,
we can always try it, and if it doesn't work out for us, we can always back out of it, right?
There's
we're not
no
signing any contract.
There is,
or,
we're not signing a contract. But this is just a one-time thing.
Okay.
So
try it.
Would one of you like to?
Well, I read it, so he has to make it right. Does he have to confirm it or whatever?
Yes.
I don't know.
You read it, but oh, I see. Did you moved it, or you were just reading it?
Well, I'll move it.
Okay, so moved by.
Okay.
Seconded by Mike. Any other comments or discussions? All those in favor say aye.
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 We have a bill from attorneys at law for the planning board.
Yeah, is that 9,000? I mean,
993.30.
That's from Attorney Radigan.
Oh,
that's
oh,
the
oh,
one
oh,
that we were
oh,
talking
oh.
about.
Oh, okay. Oh, he doesn't. He's not listed there.
It doesn't say Radigan anywhere.
Yeah.
He's not one of the partners.
Mm-hmm. Under is he there? Is he listed under professional services and the description? What he did.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
All right. So that and what is the remind me of the actual amount again?
$993.30.
So pretty much $1,000. All right. So that's the one we're going to talk to John Krebs. Say we're going to pay it.
Okay.
You know, we wish the misunderstanding hadn't taken place, and it will come out of the planning board consultant that line.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So we don't have to do anything.
Okay.
This is a letter to you about the Land and Water Conservation Fund Program, Compliance and Property Stewardship from the state of New Hampshire. Do you want to read it?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Oh, all right, I do know a little bit more about this, I think. So this, this group is at least the state group, the you know, the Department of Natural and Cultural Resources,
sure.
Division of Parks and Recs,
yep.
They oversee some of the conservation land that we had around Scotland that
okay.
we received some federal funds for. So they do an audit every so often to make sure that you know we haven't turned it into a parking lot or something like that.
Housing project.
Housing project. And in fact, the last time they did the audit, or one of the last times they did the audit, there was an issue because, in fact, the transfer station had encroached upon some of the conservation land. And so this happened way before I was on board. I just learned about it when we were trying to sell Jimmy Jalbert some land.
Al
told us about this, and so they had to do what's called, I think, a conversion. So we had to do like a land swap. Whatever the amount of land that we ended up using for the transfer station, we had to carve out an equivalent amount of land and put that in conservation.
Oh, okay.
I don't know what the map looks like, I just know that that's what we did. So this group is just coming back to do another audit. So this is an FYI. That's my understanding of what they're doing. They're just letting us know.
Okay. This one? All right, these were all we already talked about. This is the bridges and the wardens.
All right, yeah, we need to get Caroline.
We need to get, arrange a meeting that includes Avatar Monday evening, please.
Yeah, this is, remember we've talked about this? This is Eversource or somebody wanting an abatement,
yep.
And we said, okay, come talk to us.
Yep.
But
that's, so that's.
Both of those, I think, are.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's being done. Yep. That's it.
All right. I think this we're done. Any community input?
Yes. I wanted to talk a bit about the newsletter.
Yes. What you? I didn't see a deadline date. When are you hoping to get?
Oh, well, for that, May 11th will be the deadline. I have to have everything to Andrea's going on the 23rd of May.
Okay.
But I was thinking more about content.
Okay.
I think one you need to do, you know, about
we'll
projects.
Do what's currently happening.
But I think about the SB2. People need to know how that impacts them and what the process is. I thought this time we need some kind of education as to be what to be looking for. In the fall, you're going to be talking about specifics.
Well, I'm not sure that we fully understand what the impact
is. So what the dates of... not all the dates have been set yet, right? So.
No, but how does it work? I don't think anyone knows how it works.
Well, yeah, it's going to be
what the changes.
So some of the changes that are possible, and we need to talk to the town clerk about this, is that, you know, she was concerned that the balloting, because, you know, right now, the town ballot is generally small, right? So the town ballot is going to be bigger,
yeah,
right?
Have
so there's going to be more. So the programming is going to be more expensive, and the printing is going to be more expensive. So it'll be a bigger ballot, and you know, probably on two sides,
mm-hmm.
you know, just like the school. So so both of those will be more expensive. The other thing that she is worried about is throughput, and throughput for people voting. So can we get people through the line sufficiently quick enough, one vote counting machine. Do we need another vote counting machine?
Right.
That was something that she questioned.
Well, I don't think that any of that needs to be in the newsletter, but I think
it's too soon. I don't know.
Yeah.
I wouldn't.
Yeah,
yeah,
no,
but
I wasn't talking about that.
But maybe December. I'm wanting to start our budgeting process sooner. Both the
mm-hmm.
CIP and the rest of it. So, you know, at some point when I have time, I was going to write give a proposal to the board to consider. Because I thought last year we were having some things just right down to the wire. And
right.
we have so many documents now that are dependent. You know, so you make a change here, and it changes these other things.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody has to make those changes. And it takes time.
I think maybe an informational session for folks, whether it's put on by the Municipal Association, whoever. Or even by the town moderator just going through the process. People are used to it for the school side, it's going to be the same.
Yeah, it's essentially
but,
the same.
But just having them.
Well, I think it's bigger though for the town. Like you said, with all of the Warren articles, that's all on the ballot.
Right, no, yeah, that I get. But I don't think it needs to be in the newsletter. What should be in the newsletter is announcing if we have a time for it yet, the date that would happen.
Yeah,
I don't know how you would have a
budget committee hasn't met. We haven't
right.
talked about it.
Right, exactly. So,
I mean, you know, it's not a bad idea, but obviously, you know, we're a little flat-footed
mm-hmm.
ourselves and are still dealing with some of the other things that we're having to deal with.
It should be separate from that, but we should have an informational session for folks.
Yeah, I mean, it may just be a separate I don't know if it's a mailer to everybody, but certainly something on the town website, but.
Because I'm a little confused on, I mean, I understand the school side of it, because we've been doing it for several years now, but, I mean, we aren't able to, we won't be able to combine them at all either, will we?
What do you mean by combine?
Well, we used to.
With the school?
For delivery sessions and stuff like that, we used to have joint review meetings before the budget committee made their final, I don't think that you, can you have those? I don't know.
You could, the budget committee could in fact host the school and the town at the same day, and they talked about it last year, I think, and the budget committee just ends up saying, it's too much. It's too much for townspeople, as well as the budget committee.
Well.
I mean, but they.
I found it to be a lot, and just be done with it, you know, and that was my question.
Yeah, well, I would say, you know, bring it up again, because that was more, that referred to the public hearing on the.
The public hearing.
On the budgets.
Exactly.
So that's really a budget committee, you know, that's a budget.
Deliveries will have to be separate, because.
They will have to, yeah, be separate.
Because that's like you're placing them at a town meeting.
But it's not, it should be in the newsletter, I don't think we're.
I'm sorry, what might sit there?
Getting back to what was brought up, I don't think that we're ready to have it be part of the newsletter, because I don't think we all understand on this side of the table.
Yeah, but it was a good idea, and I thank you for that.
To have something in there, but.
We'll get our heads.
But maybe we can get, look into having someone come and talk the process to the town, and maybe have a date for a meeting.
Maybe I mean, it's the same as the school, we just have to be careful about the dates, and the municipal association will publish, and may have them out already, the dates.
Calendar.
Yeah, you know, how to work yourself back from the, was it the second Tuesday in March?
Yeah.
You have to work yourself back to make sure you got the windows that are appropriate. You know, we could we have a warrant article for a police station? It's possible. I don't know, I mean, I haven't been hearing from that group. It takes, you know, we should have at least one public hearing, and probably more than one, just before we actually even do a warrant article, because we need.
Well, we haven't had a scheduled meeting, Bob was waiting for something, I'm not sure what he was waiting for, I'll get.
Are you the one who's peered out, okay.
I'll get in contact with him, so we need to get moving on this.
We need to get the town engaged.
Yeah.
And I'm not talking about like the finished product, but just even, look, here's what we've done, here's the, we did an RFP, you know, these are the pot, so that we can get some feedback, because.
Yeah.
You know, sort of like the school, when the school did its, kind of like a preliminary thing on for the $7 million, it became pretty clear to them.
We don't want to do it, right?
Right?
Yep.
So that would be helpful, I think, to get some kind of feel, who even turns out, you know, who is turning out, what are they thinking?
No, I'll touch base with Chief.
Because it's a lot of work to do, having just done it last year.
Yeah.
And so, if we're even gonna get.
You may have more restrictions on what you're doing, and I don't know.
I don't think so, because I think the dates are the same, you need, the constraints are the same, so if you're going to go for long-term financing, you need to have a public hearing on just that, right? So many days before, let's say, the deliberative session, and so many days after the, you know, whatever, they're dates. And so they will be known, and that has to happen, and then it's just you know, people will vote on the ballot, and it will just be yes or no, and it will still be the, whatever it is it three-fifths or three-fifths majority for a long-term. So.
All right, I'll.
But it's all, yeah, I think we should start to schedule some, again, just to, here's what the group has done, here's some of the information we have, and, okay. Anything else, Sally, that we're on community input, are we good? All right, board, ready to go?
Yes.
Excellent, thank you.